subsystem. EDAC stands for Error Detection and Correction, and is a fairly dull industry acronym. But the kernel maintainers, which I think slightly out of character, didn't like it when it was called Blue Smoke, so they wanted something a bit more formal. And I didn't have any involvement with the EDAC name, but they could have come up with something better than that. Never mind. So EDAC this is. So there's quite a lot of hardware built into computers, mainly server computers, but actually pretty much everything these days has error detection built into PCI bus, and a lot of systems, if you spend the extra on ECC RAM, there's error detection and correction goes on preventing memory errors, which is good, which is what you want. There's all sorts of status registers and other information made available by the hardware, but the hardware engineers go to a lot of trouble to engineer this, and nobody looks at it at all ever, which is a bit strange, but I don't really know why it is. Solaris looks at it a bit, but not much else. Occasionally, HP will produce a Windows driver which is specific to the hardware and goes and pokes around with this stuff, but otherwise it's all ignored. So you get all these errors occurring on hardware, and the hardware engineers have gone to a lot of trouble to engineer all this stuff in and flag errors up and no, I'm not listening. It's the general policy for most operating systems, including Linux, up until now. So there's two halves to it, kernel space stuff and the user space utilities. It's really helpful for system administrators mainly. It stops them, allows you to spot hardware before you put it in, faulty hardware before you put it in service. Gives you handy information on what's gone wrong. It's intended to be a sort of general purpose framework, but at the moment it does PCI parity errors and main system RAM ECC errors. I think on a couple of particular systems it does cache ECC errors as well, but I think they're non-x86 stuff at the moment. Okay. The great thing about using it is that it's really the subtle hardware errors that it catches. So memory errors, 2 plus 2 no longer is 4, and things fail, basically, as they assume it would be. And PCI data transfers, it's really the most important sort of errors you can catch is transfers between main memory and hard disk controllers. Because if you get a corruption on, you get corrupted data on disk, or if you're reading it, corrupted data in RAM, and you don't know about it, then that's bad. So the EDAC system provides mechanism, the policy is up to the system administrator, so you might just want to know about the error, or you might want to. So some people in sort of private, Lawrence Livermore National Labs use this, and they do lots of computation for the US government on things like simulating nuclear explosions. And if they get an EDAC error, their policy is to panic the machine instantly, because they don't want the wrong answer to show up in anything they write out the disk, which you can understand. Another big thing that it does, it doesn't just tell you there is an error, it has a good go at telling you where the error is, so it'll tell you an error occurred whilst reading or writing from this particular PCI slot, LSPCI, oh that's my sound card, that's the one, which is what I found yesterday on this laptop while I was testing it, I have PCI parity errors going to from my sound card. Also, it's also very useful on memory. As long as it knows something about your motherboard, it's quite easy to fill in the missing information. It can tell you which memory slot in the system is experiencing failures, and you need to create a mapping between the chipset's idea of a logical memory slot and the actual physical position of your motherboard. But once you've done that, it'll say DIMM slot 4, DIMM here. So there has been quite a long history of getting something like this to work, and it seems to be very, very slow in coming. There was an initial project done about 6 or 7 years ago, which never got as far as the mainline kernel because the code was a big mess, basically. And it gradually bit rotted and fell out of usage. Red Hat did actually ship it for a while, but nobody else did, as far as I know. So this guy called Thane Harbaugh came along and rewrote it in a more logical, consistent manner. And it's SMP safe, which the old one wasn't, for instance. And you can read the code, which you couldn't on the old one. That only did ECC memory errors, but PCI parity errors were added because they're really trivial to test for. Pretty much all PCI hardware is very consistent. PCI error checking is a few lines of code that works on all PCI machines because the parity checking is part of the PCI standard, and where you go and check for it on a bridge chip or a PCI device is part of the PCI standard, so it's really easy to check for. So EDAC went into the mainline kernel in 2.6.16. The SysFS API wasn't in 2.6.16. That's been added since. I think it went in 2.6.18, but it's not fully stable yet. So if you're writing stuff against it, we're not supposed to change it, but we're going to need to. It's marked as, I think the code's still marked as experimental in the kernel, so I think we are just about allowed to move around the SysFS API without the upstream kernel maintainers being too upset. Okay, the kernel space stuff, a guy called Doug Thompson, who used to work for Linux Networks, they sell Linux clusters to people, so they'll sell you 2 racks full of high performance computing. To do whatever your big biology or physics problem. So pretty much every PCI based system from like a little ARM based slug up to some monster thing with 18 PCI buses is supported for PCI error checking. For RAM, about 90% of recent machines with ECC RAMs are supported for error checking. On x86, and a few PowerPC and MIPS things are starting to be written, to be supported as well. Currently the mechanism is polling from kernel space. There is, if you've got a lot of PCI devices, there is a bit of an overhead, a few tenths of a, it's less than 1%, but it's at the standard polling interval, but you can turn down the polling interval if you want. The reason it's polled is that the mechanisms for polling are consistent and they work, but the interrupt-driven reporting is not always very well tested on the hardware, and it's a little bit less consistent between machines as to how you set up the hardware to interrupt you when an error occurs. So the polling works and is well tested, but the interrupt-driven stuff isn't so well tested yet. But long term, we'd like to have it all interrupted because that's a lot neater, really. Okay, currently also the user space holds the kernel space, which is a bit ugly. Not particularly expensive, just reading a SysFS file, but it needs re-implementing, an additional mechanism needs implementing so that the kernel space can poke the user space when something goes wrong. And the kernel space stuff is in the edge kernel. User space stuff has been written more recently by Lawrence Livermore National Labs in California. There's an access library and a couple of minor line utilities. They're not mature yet by any means. This is more or less LL, NL, six panel homes. You don't actually need it if you just want to write a little Perl script to reach SysFS variables. You can do that yourself instead. But long term, this is my aim, is to get this in Debian in the next release. I've done a little bit of packaging of it in the last couple of days, but there's quite a lot of upstream bugs. So I started off packaging it and then spent the next 2 days fixing upstream issues. There is a Debian subdirectory in the upstream subversion. If you want to build a Debian package, you can, but it's not really that useful yet, unfortunately. Currently, if you just want to monitor PCI errors and not ECC on the system, it goes, no ECC, and doesn't really let you do that at the moment, but hopefully that'll be fixed in the next couple of days. Okay, PCI parity errors. Is everybody familiar with the concept of parity checking on data? Is anybody not familiar with parity checking on data? Good. Now, the good thing is, those nice people at the PCI Special Interest Group have mandated PCI parity checking, unless the only things that you're not allowed, the only things that you don't have to do PCI parity checking on is stuff data integrity is not essential, like dumb frame buffers. If you've got a pixel wrong, they say, oh, you don't really care. And also, if you never ever expect your device, your PCI chip, to be built onto an expansion card, then you're allowed to skip it. But in effect, 99% plus of PCI devices support parity checking, or at least claim to. You have to turn it on, and a lot of BIOSes don't, but there is code in EDAC to enable it. So as I mentioned before, most, from a sysadmin point of view, where you really don't want PCI parity errors is on hard disk controllers, but also pretty much anything, any sort of PCI parity error is bad because you can trip up a driver and the driver can crash, so even if it is a video card that's misbehaving, it can lead to system instability. And I can almost guarantee that people here have had PCI parity errors on the systems they administer and they didn't know about it. Seem to be frighteningly common. I've definitely experienced them. I've got 40 sound chip on this laptop, and I didn't know about it until the sound was a bit unstable, and I had to work out why. Oh, there's PCI data parity errors. Okay, common causes, dirty connectors on PCI cards, faulty PCI cards, faulty motherboards, bad design, or faults occurred in that particular unit. Bad power supplies can cause data glitches. This is a very good way to catch them. You've got a noisy power supply, can upset your PCI transfers. And occasionally, there are unfortunately, some PCI ICs, because this stuff has been traditionally so infrequently used, a few faulty chips have slipped through the net. So there's a bit of a chicken and egg problem. We need a good blacklist for those chips, otherwise we worry users with false positives. Because when it first went into the kernel, a few users were reporting these false positives, the upstream kernel maintainers decided to turn it off by default. So it's off by default because we don't have a good blacklist, but we don't have that many users, so we don't have a good blacklist because it's off by default. So if you test it and find any misbehaving cards, please update the blacklist, which is on the wiki, which is currently empty. Okay, people are familiar with how ECC RAM works, pretty much. Anybody like a quick overview? No? Everyone's happy? Good. Okay, so again, you guys probably know this, but memory areas, faulty RAM chips, faulty boards, again, dirty edge connectors, overclocked RAM. Those are the sort of obvious causes. The non-obvious causes are cosmic radiation And if you've got enough RAM, you will get memory errors because that's the way the universe works. And you know, even if your hardware is in full working order, you will be getting memory errors. Hopefully your ECC is going to cope with that, but it'll be nice to know. The way that most motherboards are set up, they will only tell you about uncorrectable memory errors. So you can have a DIMM with one chip on it entirely bad, and it will just appear to work, but that DIMM isn't an error correcting DIMM anymore, because every single read is getting an error, it's being corrected. But if you get any further errors in another chip, then you'll see corrupted data. So without EDAC, you don't know about this at all. I've seen this on a system where it appeared to be working fine, and in fact it was working fine, but EDAC reported every single read to main memory was picking up errors, and one of the chips on the DIMM was entirely not working and hadn't been perhaps since it was installed. And so that's not really an ECC DIMM anymore. If you do get something like cosmic radiation causing an error elsewhere on the DIMM, which will happen definitely in the lifetime of the DIMM, then that would be an uncorrectable error. So yes, the kernel space included in Etch, you just need to download the user space stuff, or if you want to drive CSFS directly, you can do that. If you do that, then you will have to turn it on. You get a /sys devices system EDAC subdirectory, and there's a little switch in there which you can echo 1-2, and it'll enable PCI parity detection once the kernel module's loaded. Okay, I'll cover this slightly, but if you don't have EDAC loaded, probably your PCI parity errors are going to go unchecked, and you will get data corruption and not know about it. If you get any correctable RAM errors, nothing on the system knows. And actually, on some systems, if you get uncorrectable ones, they're not properly set up to tell you either. So, but on most systems, on most x86 systems, you'll see an NMI gets triggered on when the first uncorrectable error occurs. Only the first one, because if you don't clear the error, then no further NMIs occur. And you usually get that message here in your kernel log. That's like, it's better than nothing, but it doesn't give you any indication of whether it is actually a RAM error, and it doesn't tell you which chips has got an error, and whether it's a one-off or whether it's happening on a continuous basis.
What about IPMI and the system event log in the BIOS?
Yes, some systems have out-of-band methods to report this, and they're basically, in which case IPMI is basically doing what EDAC does. But if you have a system which doesn't implement this stuff behind the kernel's back, you don't know. So yeah, there's a few exceptions. There are some systems which do check this stuff using something like IPMI, which is basically, is everybody familiar with IPMI? IPMI is a slightly funky management spec from Intel originally and a few other people. But basically you have an extra computer, a little extra embedded computer which runs on your motherboard, which the kernel doesn't get to see, but it sort of takes care of hardware. And it has weird things like backdoors into the Ethernet chips, so it can communicate down the network while the kernel doesn't know and stuff. So you can implement things like fan failures, over temperatures, that sort of monitoring on this spare other computer in the IPMI spec, and yes, some of the systems do also check ECC and parity errors. Some of them don't do it very well, so they can actually corrupt PCI transfers, because they can try and do PCI transfers, and if they interrupt the kernel when it's doing a PCI transfer, when it's doing a PCI configuration action, then they can corrupt those. So yes, some biases do have mechanisms for taking care of this themselves and will fit in the event log somewhere, but actually a lot of them do it in a badly designed way and can cause as much trouble as they solve by tripping up the kernel when it's trying to do PCI stuff. Feel free to interrupt me at any point if anything's not clear. I should have said earlier. Okay, when you've got EDAC loaded and configured properly, you get these counter. There's various counter files which turn up under /sys, and these include these will give you memory error counts. You also get if there's an error, you also get a log in the kernel log telling you what's happened, and you get the address of a memory error, and if you told the EDAC subsystem about how that maps to your motherboard, it'll tell you which slot has got the error, and you will get a PCI slot number for any PCI interference, and you get a number of counts. You can work out error frequency and that sort of thing. So we really need more people, we really need more testers, and we really need more developers. It's got a bit better. There's a few embedded companies which are now contributing code and helping stuff along. But we do really suffer from lack of development time. It's a sort of chicken and egg thing, because it's not super stable and super well tested at this stage. So we haven't got very many users. If we had more users, we'd get more testers, et cetera, et cetera. So it's having a frustratingly slow takeoff at the moment, but it is, momentum is gathering. Okay, and if you find you haven't got support for your hardware, these are some really easy kernel drivers to write. I wrote my first one in a day, not having written a kernel device driver before. So if you want your name in lights in the Linux kernel, this is a good way to do it. Okay, any questions at this stage?
How about is PCI Express,
the new standard?
So yeah, you're asking whether PCI Express errors are also reported. Yes, basically PCI Express spec, even though it's implemented very differently, I believe all the registers are in the same place in the backward compatible way, and it should just work on PCI Express as well. Anyone else?
Oh, how does it currently present errors if the user space stuff isn't quite there and I enable my kernel module? What do I need to do to actually start seeing things, and how will I see them?
Well, you can. There is some devices. There's some special files which turn up under /sys, and you can write a cron job or something to check that these are non-zero, and send you an email when that happens. If you've got some sort of log monitoring stuff, that's probably going to pick up the kernel message logs as well.
Right, so there's a kernel message as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, whenever you get an error, you get something in the kernel message log. You get a sort of human readable thing in the kernel message log, and you get a machine readable thing turn up under /sys. Okay. There's some sort of future plans. We could be more intelligent. We could inform device drivers about failing PCI devices so they can do clever stuff like retry a transaction, that sort of thing. It would also be good if you've got bad RAM on the system or RAM that you suspect is going bad because you're getting correctable errors now. A good thing to do is to stop using that bit of RAM. This sort of stuff should be implementable, that hasn't been implemented yet. So again, if you fancy some kernel hacking, there's some good opportunities there at the moment. And as I mentioned before, yeah, it needs to be more interoperable. You can actually do some of this stuff just using NSPCI. If you want to, if you don't want to use EDAC, you want to drive it yourself in user space, you can turn on PCI, parity error checking, using setPCI, and you can read error statuses in user space using NSPCI. Any other questions?
You had a comment on an earlier slide about CVS quilt patches for AMD Opteron and AMD64 things. Does that mean that you need to apply some patches while you use raw kernel?
Yeah, there was a bit of... It took a while for the... There is some overlap with some code that's been in the AMD64 kernels for a while. And for a while there was some resistance from upstream to putting the EDAC AMD K8 drivers in. But they are now, that has gone in to, perhaps it's gonna go into the next stage of kernel. So yeah, currently if you want AMD64 support, then you have to build the drivers from the EDAC project. You don't get them in the stable kernel in the version that's in Edge. That goes for all AMD 64-bit chips, because their architecture is that the memory controller is built into the CPU. So one driver does all of them, does the Athlon 64 does the control. Anyone else? That's it then. Thank you very much.